So hi, and welcome to A Course in Miracles with Miracles One. This is Rev Deb, and along with me, Rev Deb Phelps, and along with me is Gayle Bartlett and Mary Dole. Hello, ladies.
Good morning.
It's been a while since the three of us have been together.
Good morning, afternoon, and evening.
Hi, everybody.
So we're back at looking at the text this time, and we had a great session. Gayle and I, we missed you, Mary, of course, during the Q&A session. So this time we're looking at the text, chapter 1, section 4, the escape from darkness. It'll be a great one to look at here. So without further ado, let's get rolling here. So the escape from darkness. So we're on page 11 in the text. So we're still in chapter 1. Yes, it's taken us several months. We're still in chapter 1. But that's okay. That doesn't matter. Who's counting anyway? So the escape from darkness involves two stages. First, the recognition that darkness cannot hide, and this step usually entails fear. Second, the recognition that there is nothing you want to hide, even if you could. And this step brings escape from fear. When you have been willing to hide nothing, you will not only be willing to enter into communion, but will also understand peace and joy. Holiness can never be really hidden in darkness, but you can deceive yourself about it. This deception makes you fearful because you realize in your heart it is a deception, and you exert enormous efforts to establish its reality. The miracle sets reality where it belongs. Reality belongs only to spirit, and the miracle acknowledges only truth. It thus dispels illusions about yourself and puts you in communion with yourself and God. The miracle joins in the atonement by placing the mind in the service of the Holy Spirit. This establishes the proper function of the mind and corrects its errors, which are merely lacks of love. Your mind can be possessed by illusions, but spirit is eternally free. If a mind perceives without love, it perceives an empty shell and is unaware of the spirit within. But the atonement restores spirit to its proper place. The mind that serves spirit is invulnerable. That's pretty cool, if I say so myself. I just love the last line right there. The mind that serves spirit is invulnerable. So who am I serving? It kind of reminds me, I guess, from the Bible, you know, you can't serve two masters. I think he brings it up in the Course too. So if I'm serving spirit, well, then I'm invulnerable, because that's placing me where I truly am, the truth of me, who I really am. And so if we go back to the beginning there, so there's two stages to the escaping darkness, and it's recognizing that we can't hide in the darkness. And secondly, we can't hide to begin with. There's nothing to hide from. So, yeah. So when we understand that we can't hide anything, you won't be willing to enter into communion, but it will also understand peace and joy. So no hiding. Let's not hide. Let's be who we truly are and realize that. So I guess I'm done. I'll pass the ball along.
This is Mary. One of the lessons this week, we're in a review, the first review, and I don't remember which lesson it is, but it says, reality is never frightening. You know, I think this goes along with escaping from darkness, knowing that there's nothing, what is real isn't scary. You know, I'm a lover of fantasy literature. I'm a huge Tolkien fan. And one of the things I love about it is that the reality that you see in a lot of books, if they're written well, that is usually one that's expansive and free. And there may be challenges that the people involved in the story meet, but there's always hope. There's always hope. And so as we read this section about escaping from darkness, that lesson came back to me about reality is never frightening, because often in what is called realistic literature, there's all kinds of frightening things happening. And I think that misrepresents what is really true. So I am really grateful that reality is never frightening and that there is nothing to hide, and we don't have to hide, that we can live our lives in openness and be invulnerable, opening our hearts and not being afraid to do so. And I'm done.
Well, sometimes the text, I feel as though I'm trying too hard to understand it, you know? I've talked about that before. And it's been so long since I revisited the beginning of the text. But I was thinking about an experience I had last week, which I shared in our circle of peace, or made reference to. But I want to give you an example of what I think Jesus means, at least means to me. And that is, I have a friend on our cul-de-sac, and I've talked about Gayle many, many times. I've actually been a bit of a broken record about it. And in the last 2 months since they've been gone to Florida, I've had numerous situations where I've had to ship things to them or get water meter reading notices from the water department saying that they can't get inside, they can't get outside, the water meter outside their home is malfunctioning and so forth. And just a number of things without elaborating. And every year it's something. I've done this 6 or 7 years now, and I water her plants and flush the toilets and run their sinks and open their cabinets so the pipes don't freeze and so forth. And what I realized increasingly, because I finally let it go after being consumed by it for a couple weeks, was that that's something I want to hide from spirit. I want to hang on to these grievances. I want to be right. I want to feel superior. I want to think to myself, I would never do that to anyone. I would never impose on anyone for 6 months. Never. I wouldn't think of doing that. The problem for me has been in the name of specialness, in the name of seeking approval, in the name of wanting to be loved, in the name of wanting to be liked, in the name of wanting to be accepted, I've said yes when I meant no. I have had tremendous difficulty my whole life in setting boundaries. My entire life, I've said yes. And then I've done things that I haven't wanted to do, and then I've really resented the hell out of it. And so I think for me, Jesus is saying in paragraph 2, sentence 7, this establishes the proper function of the mind and corrects its errors, which are merely lacks of love. So what I'm realizing is that what I thought in enabling people all these decades, I'm realizing that wasn't love. It wasn't. I mean, and that's been hard for me to accept, because it removes the identity I've had to being gracious and generous and kind and forbearing and all those things for my identity. But to their points, the mind that serves spirit is invulnerable, and if I'm willing to hide nothing, I think what I found in my studying the Course in Miracles, which Mary and Deb, Rev Deb would say as well, is that you find as you study the Course that you'll see that what you didn't think you were hiding, you were hiding. What you thought you were putting on the altar, you weren't putting on the altar. It may have been perfunctory, it may have been obligatory or whatever. But when I realized the extent to which I was consumed by my anger toward Gayle and Dennis, I don't want to live that way. So I finally got to the point, my last comment, is that the pain that was in my mind and within my heart was preventing me from feeling peaceful. So why would I, they do the best they can. It's like when I get upset with our leader in the United States, he's our brother too. I don't want to cling to animosity and thinking, oh my God, I cannot stand this because it hurts me. And Jesus says, it's okay to say, it's harmful to me because I'm not peaceful. So I find that I don't feel any, bear with me, I don't feel any shame about admitting this, because by putting it on the altar and realizing I don't want to hide anything, the shame is gone too. The embarrassment that I've been doing this for so many years. I'm done.
And then we might take a different step further too. As you guys know, and I probably mentioned it back in September when we were doing the podcast then, is when the person I had that was using my studio and wanted to kept calling herself my partner, but she never contributed financially at all, which I had a lot of resentment, you know, as time went on. It was only 5 months. And there was one excuse after another, blah, blah, blah. And I remember having a lot of resentment. And it was like I had to really be with it. And there was like this final, like, you know, the straw that broke the camel's back. And instead of like blowing up or what have you, it's like I really spent time with spirit. And then I was able to give a measured response, a matter of fact response, a set a boundary of which she didn't want to follow. She didn't want to pay me. So it just came down to, she just didn't want to pay me. I guess she thought I should just give her space and she doesn't have to pay me for using it, but that's okay. That's where she is. And maybe she needed that boundary set in her life, knowing some of her history. So, you know, we never know what it is when we're in these relationships, you know, because it was an escape from fear for me of speaking up and saying, this is my boundary and this is what's going on. And it was just a very clear, vivid lesson that I had and what was coming up for me is, and I did complain, you know, there were times in my mind I was complaining to friends, but when it came down to it, when I really just sat with it and been with it, it was like, okay, well, what is correct here? You know, where is spirit leading me? And when I can speak from that place of truth and trust within my heart, then it makes a big difference, you know, and I wish her well in her journey, wherever she is. I don't know. So let's get back. Actually, this is only 4 paragraphs, which is great. So darkness is lack of light, as sin is lack of love. It has no unique properties of its own. It's an example of the scarcity belief from which only error can proceed. Truth is always abundant. Those who perceive and acknowledge that they have everything have no needs of any kind. The purpose of the entailment, which is the undoing of fear, right, is to restore everything to you, or rather to restore it to your awareness. You were given everything when you were created, just as everyone was. The emptiness engendered by fear must be replaced by forgiveness. That is what the Bible means by there is no death, and why I could demonstrate that death does not exist. I came to fulfill the law by reinterpreting it. The law itself, if properly understood, offers only protection. It is those who have not yet changed their minds who brought the hellfire concept into it. I assure you that I will witness for anyone who lets me, and to whatever extent he permits it. Your witnessing demonstrates your belief and thus strengthens it. Those who witness for me are expressing through their miracles that they have abandoned the belief in deprivation in favor of the abundance they have learned belongs to them. They're restoring everything to us. There is no death. Once again, the last line, you know, abandon the belief in deprivation in favor of the abundance they have learned belongs to them. I know in Paul's toolbox this week, which is week 8, so if you're listening to this at a different time, I think it was in the reading. I can't remember if it was in our study group sharing. I happened to go yesterday. And there was this thing where we descended from our magnitude to littleness. Maybe it is in the reading this week. It's the end of sickness. I know that is the text section. And that's what it is, what we've done. We have forgotten who we are. We allowed ourselves to descend into this littleness, this belief in deprivation that I can't have anything nice. You ever hear that kind of statement? You know, it's like, you know, I just can't have anything nice around here. But it's like we have the abundance. We just don't realize it. It's when we, bitch and complain. You know, we, in our discussion yesterday, I shared some things. And I really am trying to find in my life a peacefulness about whatever it is that comes up. Like I was telling the gals before we started that, you know, it's like I had two of my cats had a drop off at appointment this morning. And, you know, it's like, oh, they both went in their crates easily, you know, no problems at all. And got, you know, they got them in the car and I'm all by myself doing this because nobody else is here. And I had like a green light, all the green lights all the way there, you know, and I'm all happy and everything. And then I go in and I talk with the I guess it's a nurse per se or a vet assistant or whatever. And she said, oh, did they eat today? And I said, yeah. And she says, well, they weren't supposed to eat today because they were also supposed to have, besides their shots and comprehensive, you know, their dental, which they have to put them under for the dental. And I was like, oh, oops. I said, I guess my day didn't go as well as I planned. You know, I'm starting to think that. And she said, oh, yeah, that's kind of crappy that you had such a nice day. It was like, this was like 7:45 in the morning. And she's telling me this. And I'm thinking, so I walked out and I'm thinking, you know what? I don't want to be in that mode that, okay, my entire day is ruined now because, you know, I forgot one thing. You know, if we allow our lives to be ruined every time we forget one thing first thing in the morning or midday or evening or whatever, it's like, what is that going to do for us? And so it's like, okay, well, maybe there's some good that's going to come out of this, you know? There's always good in everything. It's like, what are we going to see? Are we going to see the deprivation or am I going to see the abundance? How about I take it that I felt great that two cats, both girls, don't like to get in those crates and they just like pretty much waltzed right in when I, because I do it in the bathroom. So there's no escapees. And I just kind of went right in. It just kind of, doop. I'll take that win today. Thank you very much, you know, and it's about shifting my mind is what it's always about. Do I want to really believe about fear about everything in my life that happens, things that don't go my way? No, I don't. I mean, if you think about your life and all the things that you'd like to happen in a day, 99% of it doesn't happen, right? We have a list this long. We don't get done. We didn't hear from this person. Why don't I just be grateful for what I have right here, right now? You know, maybe that person didn't call because I needed to sit here and peacefully meditate. You know, maybe whatever. I don't have to figure out why or anything. It's like, what is this teaching me? Instead of me trying to manipulate the world, what can it teach me to heal my mind? Right? It's like, oh, being gentle with myself because, oh, I've made a mistake and I forgot and I fed them. I mean, it's like, it could be anything that we deal with in our lives. So I'll stop there and I'm going to go over to
Well, couple of things came up as I was listening to both of you. One is, Gayle, I can relate to what you said about not being able to say no, because for many, many years I wasn't able to say no. And now I've learned how to say no graciously. You know, you don't have to go, no! You just can be gracious about it. But I totally agree with you. Then, in the reading itself, when he talks about the hellfire concept coming in, that was brought home to me yesterday. I belong to an Episcopal church, and the psalm we did for yesterday was all wrath. It was all wrath and rage and, you know, God's going to punish you. And I'm thinking, this is not what I believe anymore, you know, and most of the time we don't read that sort of psalm, but that's just what the one that came up this week in our order of readings. So I just said, nope, that's not true for me anymore. I don't believe that. So I let it go. And that's fine. And as far as, you know, being deprived, I'm very grateful right now. I had a health challenge earlier this month, and then last week I had some kind of worrisome test results. But you know what? I've decided I'm not going to worry about it. I can't do anything about it at the moment. All I can do is be gentle with myself, compassionate with myself, give myself love, and love to others, obviously. But not go into that fear mode, because that is so easy to go into. It is so easy to get scared and worried and say, oh no, what does this mean? So all three of these things came up for me as I was listening to what you had to say, and I am very grateful for every moment of every day. And right now my beautiful guide dog is lying here beside me. Oh, that was another thing. It looks like I'm going to have to retire him soon because he's developing cataracts. But I wrote to his puppy raiser, and I said, I told her what the vet had said, and I said, would you like to have him back? And she wrote me back, and she said, oh, yes, please. And I know she loves him. So it may be not, it's not going to be instantly. It may be a year before I have to retire him. But I wanted to make sure I had a place that he could go where he would be happy. So I'm just grateful for all these things, and I'm done.
Well, thank you both. I was thinking about Deb and her having fed the cats, and 2 minutes before I was coming up, I have a favorite mug. And it's a glass mug that I warm my coffee up in the microwave. And I put it down, and the bottom fell out, and I had coffee all over my clean floor because I cleaned the kitchen floor on Saturday. And I'm really good about making sure I don't spill and so forth when I've cleaned the floor with my Swiffer. So I started to laugh. I had it all over the dishwasher, which we had just cleaned. It's a stainless steel dishwasher. My socks were soaked, and here I am trying to be timely. And I thought, okay, I just need to laugh out loud because this is not a big deal. And I'm not sure. I think what I can learn from it is that I coveted that mug, and now it's gone. So it's an idol for me, you know, because it was my favorite mug, and I have a whole cupboard full of mugs. So that's firstly. Secondly, I want to share, which I shared on Thursday night too, that when Mary shared with us that she had had some tests and so forth, and her philosophy and her response, it was a wonderful opportunity for me to look at how much fear it ignited in me. Rev Deb and I have been working with Mary for years, and in various forums. And Mary, as many of you know, perhaps you don't know, helps Deb, Rev Deb, with transcribing all kinds of stuff for her, bless her. And anyway, I could go on and on about the ways in which Mary contributes. And I felt this huge sense of deprivation if something were to happen to Mary. I mean, I'm being very honest with you. I thought, I can't live without this person in my life. And I think that's what Jesus is talking about. And that sentence that both of you, I believe, reference about deprivation, those who, truth and is an example of the scarcity belief from which only, and that the purpose of the atonement is to restore, paragraph 3, everything to you, or rather to restore it to your awareness. You were given everything. So it was an opportunity to Rev Deb's point for me to say, I mean, Mary is so zen about it, is so chill about all this. And here I'm freaking out internally because I've grown accustomed to working with her. And she's a dear, dear friend and sister, brother in Christ. So I think that the whole point for me, and everybody is saying the same thing, we can use this, any segment of the whole Blue Book, as an opportunity to apply it, which is the thrust or the core of this whole ministry, is practical application. So even if it doesn't make sense, you can take the smallest, seemingly inconsequential example, like my breaking my favorite mug. Seems in the scheme of things of no consequence, but I made it important. And I can laugh at it, just like Deb did with her kitties. Now she's going to have to schlep them back. And she's praying that she remembers not to feed them so that she doesn't have to schlep over there a third time. I'm done.
Actually, when Autumn comes over for spring break, I texted her and I told her what it, because she asked how her cat was. And I said, well, this is what happened. And I said, well, guess what? I'm going to set up the appointment for when you're here so we both remember. You know, we can use tools to help us, like other people, to help us remember. And, you know, the one tool that we do have, speaking of tools, you know, I guess this whole thing with Paul's miracle toolbox each week, you know, rubs off on me. The one tool that we do have is the Holy Spirit. And it's a tool that we forget to use. You know, it's there. It's always present. It's always charged. You don't have to, you just have to plug into him, you know, pick it up, use it. You know, he's always ready to stand by and work with us. And all we have to do is ask. And that's what we need to remember in all of this. If we want to escape from darkness, we just have to ask. Put out our hand and say, hey, I need your help, Jesus. I need your help, Holy Spirit. And they're there. Just like that old song, you got a friend, you know, you can just, James Taylor, you know, you can, you know, just call out my name and I'll be there. And that's all we need to do. So I think we had a great session today. And next time, which will be about 2 weeks from now, we will be looking at our next section, which is chapter 1, section 5, Wholeness and Spirit. So I hope you'll catch us for that next one as we keep moving through the text. So thank you, ladies, for being here today. And thank you, everybody, for joining with us. And we certainly wish you much peace. Namaste.
Play button.